right. Welcome, everyone. I'm very happy to be here after we heard a bunch about gaming. I will talk about my view on an endgame. And it's not so much about gaming, but you know, some thoughts on how games and other maybe less funny things might impact your real lives on the Web3. I'm Sebastian Buergel. I'm founder of HOPR Association, and we work on Web3 privacy infrastructure. And, you know, picking up the topic from the previous speaker on gaming, you know, that's all fun, right? So you have your virtual character doing all sorts of funny things. But maybe you're also in the same environment managing more serious things, your life savings, your, you know, future children's college fund, you know, God forbid, decentralized insurance or something like this. Like, all that is real, right? All that exists. And it makes me think about privacy, like how these two things interact. And what I will go through is, in the next 20 minutes, is through some examples of, you know, where privacy matters. And, you know, it's all fun and games until it's not. And I will show some examples where you can see that already today, you're leaking some things that, you know, you might actually consider quite broken. And that might give an idea of some things that are yet to be fixed on the Web3 stack, on multiple layers of the stack. So specifically, I'll be talking about application layer stuff. I'll be talking about execution layer. I'll be talking about consensus layer and kind of some of the MEV infrastructure that has weird privacy implications in between. And specifically because at HOPR, we're working on a mixnet, so something like a VPN, but much more private. I'll be talking about transport layer anonymity and show some lack of transport layer anonymity and what that means. So yeah, I figured you're gonna see a bunch of slides, so I'm gonna show you a bunch of demos. And if anybody's interested in playing along, these are all publicly accessible, and you can, you know, yeah, play them at your own pace. Oh, well, that wasn't too good. All right. So I'll start with, since we had NFTs as a topic, right? So apparently some people still care about NFTs. That's great, right? You have funny pictures and funny assets that you move around, but like, what's an NFT really, right? It's a picture. Well, that looks cool. That could be an NFT. It's not, by the way. What happens when you see an NFT in your mobile? Well, you know, it loads a picture. Duh, right? Nothing new in there. Okay, so where's that picture loaded from? Well, typically, because in Web3 we just tend to be lazy, it's loaded from, well, AWS. Let's pick the cheapest possible option that we have, right? Just because we really actually don't care. So what happens as a result of that oversight is that there's all sorts of providers which can track every single thing we do. If you don't believe me, you can go to mint.hoppernet.org, you can mint yourself one of these kind of like gamey looking NFTs. This is like a demo NFTs, which is rendered here on the page. And it's a weird looking NFT, right? So let's take a look at this NFT. So this NFT shows me that I'm in Switzerland. Why am I in Switzerland? Well, because I'm using my Swiss mobile phone that's connected. I'm connected to my hotspot here, right? Shows me like my preferred language settings of my browser version, operating system and device, and my IP address. That's weird. What's going on here, right? So, okay, we render an NFT. This is kind of server-side rendered. Just to put it in your face, what sort of metadata is being extracted while your wallet loads an NFT. And what you can do here, this works on mainnet, which might be a bit expensive. If you want a cheaper version, you can try it out on Gnosis chain. You can mint one of these NFTs. It doesn't cost anything. It just allows you to mint this thing and watch it in your wallet. That's usually quite insightful to just, you know, visualize to people what an NFT actually means and what metadata means. All of that shown on that NFT is a metadata fingerprint of you, your wallet, and your device as you look at some NFT. Now, just in case you use that on a mobile wallet or some wallets, and you see a weird IP address that's not yours, that's because some like wallet providers are, you know, since we talked about this for a bit, you know, aware of that and are proxying requests. So it doesn't mean that your data is not leaking. It just means it's leaking to some other party than you think it is, right? So, okay, so that's on the NFT layer, and you might say, okay, Sebastian, that was pretty obvious. Yes. So let's look at something that's a bit more fun. Let's look at something that we use every single day as we interface Web3 applications. Let's look at RPC providers. So what we built also at HOPR is called DERP. DERP is basically just, it's a dumb Ethereum RPC provider. It does really nothing. It does really nothing else but serve your requests and also harvest that data and render it on this website. So FYI, this data is not being stored. This data is just being rendered for you to see what is going on there. So what you can do is you can go to derp.hoppernet.org and you can click on setup. And at this RPC provider, we provided for a bunch of chains. You know, you can use that on Polygon mainnet or on any sort of chain. And it will render the metadata that, you know, the RPC provider received and show you all requests, right? So even if you think that this is nothing new, I find this kind of educational to understand what your wallet actually does and how your wallet functions behind the scenes. So I have Rabi set up here. Like, Rabi seems to be pretty much everyone's favorite wallet. I have that one configured already. So I'm gonna log into my Rabi. And yeah, so my Rabi, I have that one configured on Gnosis chain. We see, oh, interesting, right? So I didn't actually do anything yet. I just clicked on the chain dropdown and already made a call, right? So what's going on? Like, I didn't actually really use my wallet yet, right? And there's a whole lot of information, again, about me that is out there. So at this point, you see my IP address. You again see all the additional metadata that are being sent with my request, which you see in the bottom. You know, which you can ask, does an RPC provider need that? No, obviously not. Like, that makes no sense that an RPC provider needs to know about my user agent, right? This is basically just, data that people don't care about that can be very conveniently used to, like, user track, fingerprint, and single you out, you know, to link your potentially, you know, gaming NFT to your savings account and, you know, figure out who you are, how you spend your money, how I can exploit you, and how I can use all of that against you. So the first request that Rabi made here is an ETH block number just to find out basically what time it is. And let's do something a bit more interesting. So I'm gonna just pull up some dApps here, and we will keep this derp running as a sidecar. So I'm going to go just to some DEX. So I'm going to go to Swapper, and I'm just going to go there just because it's like properly decentralized, you know, it's hosted on ENS. And if my mobile hotspot allows, we'll see what's going on here. And yeah, so what we see already is like Rabi made another, you know, another call here to block number net version before I did anything. And here already something pretty interesting is happening, right? So an ETH call is being made. An ETH call is being made, and some more stuff is happening here. And you know, none of that is really surprising to people who understand how the EVM works, right? So we need to obtain data in order to render information in the wallet or in the dApp. Again, nothing new here, right? But what I want to highlight is that before I actually made absolutely anything, you can see my wallet address, right? So you can see a bunch of metadata. This is probably like a batch request. So I think this is, if we go here on Gnosis scan and just check this address, I bet this is like a balance checker that allows you to query multiple ERC-20 balances in one go. I hope this actually was Gnosis chain. Yes, it was. If we look at the contract, yeah, it's a multi-call contract that allows you to call multiple things in one go. Yeah. All right, so, before actually doing anything, there's all this information leaking about me, which is kind of interesting. And now let's actually do something here so I can you know, I have some tiny balance here. Let's make some test transfer, finding best price. And we'll see that this one is basically continuously, it will continuously load like more RPC requests that, you know, leak information about what I'm actually doing with my wallet. It's a little bit slow here to make any actual demo. Confirm swap. Waiting for confirmation. And also sometimes what I find interesting is when you don't see requests popping up there, right? Because what that means is actually that Ruby is a very slick wallet, but what this teaches us, like what you see here is like it has a gas price, right? What you see here is there is no like ETH estimate gas, ETH gas price or something like that being made here. What does that tell you? Well, that tells you that Ruby is actually doing something that I find a bit naughty. It is making requests not through the RPC provider, but through some custom bespoke API to fetch all that information. That's not great, right? That goes against the values of empowering a user to, you know, give them control over how their wallet works and how they interface the Web3 and any sort of chain, right? So yeah, I let you explore Derp on your own. Again, you can see how in about 5 minutes, this made almost 50 calls. You can see my address that my wallet is connected to. And you can see that already now that, you know, we knew what my wallet is, you can see it highlighted here in the metadata information, how already from the get-go, from loading the page, my wallet address was disclosed. And again, this was just for fetching ERC-20 balances, right? So you see all this like nicely highlighted. This is my wallet address that kind of leaks all over the place. Cool. So again, not much new here, but the take-home message is that what is the, you know, unique identifier here? What is kind of your primary key of data harvesting? Well, most certainly you have multiple wallets, but they're all tied to the same fingerprint of metadata. For example, they're all tied to the same IP address, right? So they're all tied to this same IP address that's connected here to my hotspot. They are all most likely connected to the same user agent and, you know, other information that we don't show here. So that's not good. And again, it's all fun and games until it's not. And so, yeah, let's try to protect privacy to prevent an IP address from becoming your primary identifier on the Web3. Now, you can say, okay, well, I'm aware of that, and you know, I separate things perfectly. I want to show you something that I find even funnier. I want to show you something on the proper application layer that doesn't even touch your wallet. We created this tool here, mytokentracker.xyz, which is, you know, just lets you show what sort of tokens you have. And I just pulled out one balance here, and I think it's not just some random balance. I think it's the biggest safe that has ever been deployed. And, you know, the only thing it does here on the left side, it shows how much balance it has. You know, it has a ton of ETH. It has a bunch of other tokens. Has some, you know, meme tokens and some, I don't even know what it is, Dongcoin. Yeah, and you see on the right-hand side, this is typically what you see in the dev tools. We try to render it a bit more easily visible. You see the requests that are being made to fetch these logos, right? So, again, what you see on the left is what every, pretty much any Web3 dApp shows you. Uniswap, Aave, you know, Safe, they all show you a list of your tokens. That's kind of cool, right? But now, what does that tell about you? Well, there's some server that renders these icons, that fetches these icons. Where does it typically come from? I let you do that exercise yourself because the answer will be surprising. Where do all the Uniswap logos come from that dynamically are being loaded? So my point is, again, you are leaking metadata that is unique to you to a bunch of third parties, which is pretty fucked up, actually. So there's third parties that know what you're doing, because in the referrer, they find you're actually in app.uniswap.org. So they know which address you're connected to, because that's quite unique. And you might say, yes, Sebastian, that's certainly not unique. I mean, I hold ETH. How many people hold ETH? Everyone holds ETH, right? But what we did here is actually, we took this address and we made a dune query, right? So what we did here is we fetched all these logos. So all the logos that were being loaded here, that you see here, It's just loaded by their addresses, right? Just how you would typically load ERC20 logos. And what we did in this Dune query is we were looking for the kind of what is the entropy, right? So how many addresses hold exactly that set of tokens that I've been showing here? And the answer is interesting. So the answer is one. Oh, I'm by myself. I'm unique. We found that this address, which is showed here, which is again an address that is just the biggest safe that has been deployed, has a unique set of token icons, which were loaded there, which allows you to uniquely fingerprint this address. That's not good, right? Because that is how you link the Web3 world with the Web2 world and map identities between them without access to RPCs, without access to, you know, MEV infrastructure, without interfering with absolutely anything, just because you're leaking metadata on the transport side. Yeah, so that was all application layer. Now let's get, for the last 2 minutes, a little bit more nerdy, and let's talk about consensus layer. We all love consensus layers, validators, secure, all this greatness. That's cool. But we actually did some research, and again there, we're kind of drilling into what sort of information does your validator broadcast as you create blocks? Well, actually, you don't just create blocks, right? So your validator, what it's actually doing is it also creates attestations. So once per epoch, it is signing off on somebody else's block. That's how Ethereum works. Nothing new, again. But as it turns out, we can use that information of the attestations that your validator provides once per epoch and see from which IP address did that come from. And what we see here, so this is, we did that for our HOPR team. So every HOPR team member was running a node. So that's 11 nodes that we were running here. And we were running this over like several days, and you see that, you know, we got unique attestations from all these nodes all the time, right? So we basically managed to identify and map the pub key, which is usually considered kind of, you know, random information that we don't think much about, to their IP address. Okay, again, of course, we need the IP system, nothing new. Well, what does that mean, right? That means you can actually have a highly targeted attack on individual validators. And let's talk about homestakers, because, you know, homestakers is what Ethereum likes. We like hardcore decentralization. But that means that you can target in a highly efficient attack. I only need to take out your node for 2 seconds. You're streaming Netflix, you don't know that you were offline, but you missed your block. How often does that happen? Well, once every couple of months if you're lucky, right? So you missed your opportunity, well, tough luck. You don't even think it was bad intent, right? So, yeah, again, a sign that we do need transport layer anonymity for this to work out safely for everyone. And just finally, in a similar direction, I would just leave with an outlook for a lightning talk at DEF CON by my colleague Q. And Q has been running actually a super interesting experiment that she will show on Friday at DEF CON. And that is actually, Q has been running in a, this is a simulated environment. We, you know, did ethical hacking here, not attack actual production networks, showing what happens if we use the unique information of MEV relayers and that infrastructure and attacking the MethBoost instance, the consensus layer client, and the validator. These are three separate processes. So I'm not going to tell you which is which of these three curves. You can guess that, and you can attend Q's talk on Friday on solo staker issues at DEF CON to find out which one is which and what the implications are. But again, I would finish it off by saying transport privacy matters. That's why at HOPR we're building a mixnet to address that. The Web3 is, you know, set up to secure $1 trillion of value. If we secure $1 trillion value on Web2 infrastructure that was never intended to be private, we will be up for some really bad surprises. That's why we're here, that's why we built this extremely unsexy thing called privacy infrastructure, that's why I'm on this stage, but I'm happy that you guys listen to my talk, and yeah, let's build infrastructure to make the Web3 greater than it is today. Thank you very much.